subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
I'm with Hardeep Singh Puri, Minister in the Government for Civil Aviation, Commerce and Industry, and Urban Affairs and Housing. A lot of things on your platter, Mr. Puri. Welcome to the print.
Thank you.
I also would like to add right here, right at the start, that you're also one of the key faces of the Narendra Modi government and have been seconded to deal with a lot of issues, not entirely as part of ministerial responsibilities, for example, the farmers' agitation. So let's just start from there. The farmers have been agitating. Now it's 42, 43 days around Delhi, around the capital. Several rounds have taken place, 7 rounds, I think, but no solution seems to be emerging. What is the government's view on this, and how do you expect to break the impasse?
First of all, Jyoti, thank you very much for having me participate in this interactive session. I don't think it would be entirely appropriate to say that I've been designated to deal with the farmers' issue. I think everyone in the Council of Ministers, many of my colleagues, we have at different points of time been tasked with the specifics of reaching out to the press, reaching out to farmers groups. So I have interacted with the farmers groups and press in Chandigarh through articles and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So far as the farmers issue per se is concerned, I think we should be absolutely clear on what we are dealing with here. Mm-hmm. The legislation which was passed by both houses of parliament, yeah, if I remember correctly, in September of this year, was preceded by ordinances which were enacted in the month of May. Mm-hmm. The passage of the legislation in the Rajya Sabha, which was the final act before the bills became law,
yeah,
I was witness to that. And if there was opposition, the opposition, all it needed to do was to ensure that the members of the opposition party should have been present in the House. Mm-hmm. But 76 members of the opposition were missing. Okay. And in order to gain some traction, you see, if you sit on your seat and press the division button and ask for a division, you will have a recorded vote. But they clearly knew that they didn't have the numbers. So they decided to resort to other attention-seeking devices, which was to storm into the well of the House, use terms of endearment in different languages, get onto the presiding officer's table, break his microphone, and, you know, hurl invectives, abuses at the presiding officer, which is conduct unbecoming of a democracy anywhere. Mm-hmm. I'm choosing my word carefully, anywhere.
Okay.
Democratic processes are sacrosanct. Democratic processes must be allowed to go through. So if you didn't have the numbers, if you resort to, you know, physical violence, that's not going to be there.
But in this particular case, I think, Mr. Puri, the farmers who are agitating, actually, you don't see any opposition leaders there. In fact,
one minute.
They are protesting on their own. They really do not have...
Yes. Let me come back to that in a minute. Who's protesting on their own, etc. I am willing, for purposes of, as a hypothesis for discussion, mm-hmm, I'm willing to say that the farmers are entirely on their own. I'm willing to say, A, they're hardworking people. They are, they have given their best to the country, that as a result of the Green Revolution, we are today in the happy situation of having gone from a food importing country and PL 480 and what have you to food self-sufficiency. And if I may say, we are today in the process of becoming a global supplier in many commodities. Now that requires an entire ecosystem to fall into place.
Okay.
But look, the agitation per se was built on a certain hype, mm-hmm, that MSP would be done away with, that mandis would be done away with. I think the government has done whatever it could to try and reassure the farmers that there is no intention, whether you want MSP or not, whether you need MSP or not, given the strength of feeling on this, we will continue with MSP.
No, if you continue with MSP, but you don't want to write it into law.
First of all, MSP is not written into the law even to now. MSP is an administrative action.
Okay.
Because the MSP means that the procurement agency, which in case is the Food Corporation of India, procures the output,
the crop,
stocks it, and then makes it available in the food distribution system through a system of stockpiling.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have an international system on that also. Now it's ironical that some people are sending money from Canada for our brethren, the farmers. I saw one conservative member of parliament from Canada waxing eloquent on the farmer's bill. Do you realize that the United Kingdom, from where again my brothers and sisters are supporting the farmers' agitation, that the United Kingdom and Canada, both as members of the Cairns Group, this is a grouping in the WTO, and it was used to be in the erstwhile General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, GATT, have clearly opposed India's stockpiling of food and the grant of a minimum support price, MSP. So that's one part.
Are you saying that there is a foreign hand? Why are these...
No, I'm not saying. Let me explain to you.
Mm-hmm.
If I say there is a foreign hand, you will run with the headline. Minister says foreign hand. There's some ministers trying to say, you know, but look at the ideological orient. You'd say, unko ye vadi bana diya, wo stani bana diya, stani bana. Look, I'm not interested in all that. I'm trying to have a serious discussion. I'm explaining to you.
Mm-hmm.
What is the issue today? Government is ready for MSP. Government is saying that we will not do away with the mandis. These were the two major points on which apprehension, fear was being spread. And the third one was dispute resolution.
Right.
The laws per se don't give any implication along those lines. There's nothing in the laws which would suggest that either the mandis or MSP would be done away. There is something in the law on selling your produce, on dispute resolution, that you should, that an SDM gets ordered. That also was introduced because recent experience had shown that if you went to the civil courts, it would take a long time to sort out.
Right.
And therefore, the government is very clear that we are willing to amend that. We are willing to say that instead of dispute resolution being confined to the subdivisional officer or whoever, you can go to the civil courts also. We've conceded that. Now, you can't amend something that you've not enacted. We never said that MSP is going away. How can we amend that? Now, the discussion is becoming somewhat difficult to understand.
No, so
government is saying, let me complete. Government is saying, you want MSP, we will give you MSP. Mm-hmm. You want mandis. All we said about the mandis, and Jyoti, this is very interesting. In the year of the Lord 2004,
mm-hmm.
where an eminent technocrat, all right, a former Secretary Economic Affairs, Governor of the RBI, was chosen by the grand old party to become the Prime Minister of India. In an interview to the Wall Street Journal, he gives out elaborate reasons. This is 2004.
Are you talking about former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh?
I'm speaking precisely of that gentleman.
Okay.
He gives elaborate reason in that interview to the Wall Street Journal, which I put out on social media, on why we must give our farmers the choice. The choice. It's not restricting their choice. It's giving them the choice. That if you don't want to sell to X, you can sell to Y. If you don't want to sell here, you can sell anywhere in the country. If you don't want to sell here, you can export.
So all that choice. That the Modi government is only following in the footsteps of what...
Let me complete. The story is not over.
Okay.
This is 2004.
Yeah.
2008, when Shri Sharad Pawarji was the agriculture minister, he sets up several committees. One of those committees was headed by a gentleman called Sardar Prakash Singh Badal. Other members of this committee were people like the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, Shri Narendra Modi ji, the Chief Minister of Haryana, etc.
Right.
Please read the report of this committee set up by a UPA government, Agriculture Minister Sharad Pawar, headed by an Akali.
Who has since returned his Padma Vibhushan.
No. Well, most welcome. I mean, all the stuff that went with it can also come back. No problem. It's a great country, 7,000-year-old civilization. The period you and I are talking about, 70, 75 years, only 1% of that. Do you think anybody is going to remember what you and I returned or not? Come on, let's be serious. Now, in that report, the number of the para, if my memory is still all right, 5.13. I don't know if any of my colleagues has that para 5.13. I'll read it out to you in a few minutes. They make specifically the recommendations which are now been implemented in these three laws.
Mm-hmm.
Number two. Number three, as late as May of 2020, and right up, I will send you clips of the very people who today say that they will be opposing these laws, no matter what, my way or the highway, are extolling the virtues of this. So what happens in between? I'm only offering a hypothesis.
Yeah.
Somebody spread canards. Look, I have a social media. I'm a member of several groups. And many of these groups say, see what has happened. The private sector has done this. Private sector is acquired the land. You know, Adani's Reliance, this, that, and the other. I think we are reaching a stage that if you are spreading disinformation on social media, and that results in violence being incited, and that violence results in destruction of property, etc., I think we need to start fixing responsibility.
The Punjab Chief Minister Captain Amrinder Singh has already said that the destruction or the damage to the cell phone towers owned by Reliance or owned by an agency that is outsourced by Reliance is a very bad thing and will not be allowed. So Captain are on the same side on this one at least.
I am not talking about good thing or bad thing. Those are words in the English language which you use which show subjective good or bad. I'm coming to something more basic.
Okay.
Para 5.13, okay, yeah, of this report of 2008. Mm-hmm. Then I come to 10 years forward. 2018, there's a study by the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, which shows that 52.5% of all agricultural households are in debt. Debt on an average $1,470, which should be equivalent to 1 lakh rupees. There are 52% of the households in 1 lakh rupee debt. That this happens whilst 30% of our agricultural produce is being wasted. So anyone who decides to reform that system, now you get some uniquely Indian responses. Uniquely Indian. But if the people want it, anyway, people want to be in debt. People want not to have more money in their pockets. Who is reasoning with whom? You know, the other day I got into an interesting discussion. Two people who shall remain nameless, but you can guess. One, a very educated minister in the captain's government.
Mm-hmm. In Punjab.
Somebody I deeply respect, mm-hmm, who came to see me, has a surname which links him elsewhere, came to see me, and I asked him a simple question. And we are all putting our heads together on how to take this forward. I asked him, tell me, if the captain wanted to, could he be part of the solution now?
Uh-huh.
I asked him this question. Then I got another person.
What was the answer?
No, I'll give you. I got somebody who's not allied with our erstwhile allies, who's a very proud member of the erstwhile allies.
Mm-hmm.
All right? I asked him the same question. He called me informally. He said, koi agar rasta kado, you know, galno mukwaiye. You understand Punjabi?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, before you became an Angrez. Okay.
Let's find a way out of this. Yeah.
Yeah. Mauka tun, koi agge gal vadwaiye, mukaiye galnu. I asked him a question. Do your party leaders have the ability to try and bring this agitation under this thing? His answer and that of the minister in Captain, it was exactly the same. They don't. So what has happened is, they have instigated, fueled through fueling of misapprehension, outright lies and disinformation. They have created a narrative. After that, the janta or the genuine kasan has taken over. I am not going to comment on.
No, one second, Mr. Puri. Are you saying that Captain Amrinder Singh's government in Punjab is instigating?
No. I am not saying. They have, through a process of misapprehension going all along, we must do something for the kisan. There's a character in
they are instigating the misapprehension.
Why I am not, who am I to say they are instigating? That's why I'm having a discussion with you. I can only quote statements on the record which are there. There is a young MP in the captain's party who has great lineage, which means son, grandson of somebody who has.
Why don't you name these people?
I'm not going to, because then we start this thing. Who has one day desired to become chief minister? I quote his statement. He says, corpses will line up. I must have spoken in Punjabi and he must have used the word lasha, you know. So
yes.
Look, this is the kind of statement you get. This is the kind of statement you get. So I was having a good, I sat back and, you know, so I told this man, if your guys can't control it, then they've got worst end of both the this thing. Right? You were part of the government. You had some line open. Now you're making irresponsible statement. And nobody in the government is giving too much of a this thing. What we're doing is we're talking to the farmers. All right. Now, the problem, I wrote an article, several articles. I'm willing to send you the articles.
I've seen those.
On the need to correct, imperative of correcting a
But can I just ask you a couple of questions here?
Let me complete, then all the questions you can ask.
Sure.
Somebody said, the minister, not a friend of yours, a minister is writing articles, but minister should know that this is a people's movement. Now, one of the things I've done is I'm a student of history, and the guy writing is a student of literature who doesn't understand the ABC of people's movement. People's movements, whether it's the Arab Spring or the Anna Hazare movement, invariably end up with distortions. You have to solve the problem. There were people, I've written a book on this, I'll send it to you.
Is that what's happening to the farmers' agitation?
I'm not saying it. All I'm trying to tell you is anybody who's saying this is a people's movement, we need to reach out to those genuine people and explain to them that what you are getting is more than what you asked for. But if the answer to that is repeal or not, wait a minute, you wanted MSP, you wanted mandis. By repealing this, you don't get a guarantee. Supposing somebody turns around and says, all right, be my guest.
So is this a sort of blackmail, do you think? Either you repeal or you don't.
You are using the word. I don't want to use it. All I'm trying to tell you is...
So would you agree with me? Would you agree?
I have a different view. I am telling you that Sri Narendra Singh Tomarji is handling this with great maturity. He's telling the people, let's do a clause-by-clause reading of the 3 acts. If you do the clause-by-clause reading, it will be very clear that if there is a problem, we're willing to tweak it. But you can't come to a negotiating table. First of all, you must have a designated representative. You must have somebody who say, Jyoti Malhotra wants to negotiate with party XYZ. Jyoti must have delegated powers to negotiate. Other guys must have delegated powers to negotiate. Then you sit down a table and you are able to define the terms of reference. You're able to define what you are discussing, what you're negotiating. I am very confident in the next 6 to 8 days, after we've had our...
Eight round, nine round.
Look, difficult situation. All of us are all well-meaning people, want the farmers to have a sense of reassurance that the central government is entirely with you. We are willing to listen to what you have to say. We are willing to reassure you and willing to guide you. Now, if you had this way that, oh no, what would happen if, what if the people don't want it? This is no argument. I mean, social reform in Hinduism would never have taken place. Radha Ramon Roy would have had to throw up his hands in air. You have to guide people towards, we are in a happy, unhappy situation, that you have a situation where importing Australian wheat is cheaper than growing the wheat and making it available. We have to make our farmers more independent. They should become the granary for the world. We should not have to store it like this. Now, if there's 30% of the farm produce is being wasted, it is because the lack of infrastructure, lack of technology, lack of cold chains, etc. So I'm going to confine myself with that, and on an optimistic, upbeat mood, I'm going to tell you, we'll solve the problem.
Okay, great. So next 6 to 8 days, we're going to see how this...
See the contours of a solution, yeah.
Sure. Let me move to the next subject, Mr. Puri, which is the sale of Air India. Again, it seems to be delayed. Tell us what's going on.
There's no delay. I just want to take you through two stages. Mm-hmm. Air India is being privatized, not because X, Y, Z reason. Simple reason, either Air India is privatized or it's closed down. It has a debt, accumulated debt of 60,000 crores. Most of it, all of it, if I may say, is the creation of a previous government, right? Through bad decisions. All I can tell you is that we will get it privatized. The previous attempt was, I should choose my words carefully, not entirely comprehensive. It was a little half-hearted. They wanted to retain 26% and so on and so forth.
Right.
Now, we have a sale on enterprise value. The concerned government department used the term that there are multiple bidders. Those bids are being evaluated. I think because we thought we would do it by the 5th, I think they wanted another few days, because some of these expressions of interest need to be checked, because you don't want the shortlisted bidders for people to discover that there were flaws in that. Yeah. So I think the last date is another 7 days from now for the electronic information to come in and end of the month. So there's no delay. There is, I think, at the most a rollover of a few weeks, etc. Once the shortlisted bidders are declared, then they will have access, Jyoti, to our data archives, Air India's data archives.
Right.
And meanwhile, we will utilize that period to do some vetting and due diligence on who these bidders are.
So can you give us a little bit, tell us a little bit about how many bidders there are, if you can tell us?
I cannot. It's a classified process. It's okay. Being done by the transaction advisor. And as a matter of policy, the other government departments are not supposed to be. It's being done by an independent transaction advisor.
Whoever ultimately sort of buys Air India will take over both its assets and its liabilities, I imagine.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So whether it's the, the number of employees or the paintings and the buildings or,
I don't think the paintings are included. The paintings are going into the National Gallery of Modern Art separately. What is included is clearly set out. It's already set out there. Air India, Air India Express, I think 125 planes. I don't remember all that. Right. But it's all very clear. And all things, the bidders are doing their due diligence. They're also very clear. And I think after the bidders are shortlisted, they'll be given a period of 90 days or so in which to prepare their financial bids. And may the highest bidder win.
And this could be a foreign airline as well. I mean, or a foreign interest.
I'm not going to make any comment on that. There are qualified bidders. There is a system of 51%, etc. All that is very clear on the categories who are bidding. And I say when the bidders are shortlisted, you and I will both find out the same day.
Okay. So quick question on the flights from the UK on the COVID front, if you can just give us some. I know you've said that very soon that I think by the 8th, flights will reopen after that and there will be sort of X number of flights every day. Is there any further development on that?
Jyoti, let me just tell you that we had temporarily, and I will use the words very clearly, temporary suspension of flights took place from, I think, the 31st of last month to the 7th. Yesterday, the first flight went, which have reached there today. And tomorrow, the first flight from the UK will come. But we are running curtailed operations. We used to have 60 plus flights a week to the UK. We now will have only 50% evenly distributed between UK carriers and Indian carriers based on their market share. And we will review the situation on the 23rd. What we've added is another layer of checks. Mm-hmm. Earlier, you were required to take the RT-PCR test 72 hours before boarding. But 72 hours is a long time. You can contract the virus within the 72 hours. I mean, you cannot step out of the house, but still get a virus. Somebody else can come in. I mean, these things will happen. So we have introduced another test. So if your previous test was 72 hours, when you land, you undergo another test. Even if you test negative, even if you test negative, you still have 1 week's mandatory quarantine at home.
Right.
And we have done the genome sequencing. We have identified the people. We are very confident that those who need the vaccine will be able to deal with that strain of the virus. And we will review it around the 23rd.
Can I move on to the Central Vista? The Supreme Court has given a 2-1 verdict. That must have been music to your ears.
You know, if you end up doing the kind of job I'm doing, I start the day with many challenges. We navigate our way through. I wouldn't say music to my ears. I was confident that we had followed the rule book. I was very confident that we had not undertaken any shortcuts. I have actually read the 615-page judgment. I've actually gone through it. And I've had my lawyer, one of them is sitting here, also go through it. The important, significant point to note is that our position has been upheld on every count, on right. the legality, validity, on the DDS process, on getting all the clearances. Therefore, I say with all humility, we welcome the majority judgment, but we also welcome the minority judgment. Because the judge...
He's had a lot of things to say about it, Justice.
What he has said is, he also agrees that the project should go ahead. What he has said is, and I think this is a significant part of the minority judgment, I don't want to place a construct on it. He has said that the consultation procedure and more consultation. But the majority judgment has also said smoke towers should be put into as integrated part of the design.
I think Sanjeev Khanna, Justice Sanjeev Khanna is talking about a much more comprehensive. He said it's not enough just to put it on the Gazette and say, kya cha, notification ho gaya. So if you.
I respect that. I welcome what the learned judges said. I am going a step further. I've instructed my ministry's officials to put in the public domain all the consultations we've had. I have personally hosted them. A newspaper you used to work for them have had them.
Isn't that a bit late now? I mean, it's all...
No, not at all. We've had consultations in parliament. We've had consultations with architects. Hundreds of these have been taken place.
So now, tell me, is it right now just about the parliament building or is it the entire Central Vista project that has been cleared?
They're all segments. Insofar as parliament is concerned, I'll come to that in a minute. Once you see what we have done by way of consultation, it is entirely possible that you will think that, oh my God, there have been so many consultations. Look, let's be clear. Consultation doesn't mean that if during the course of a consultation, somebody raises a point which has the effect of derailing the project and I'm obliged to accept it. In a constitutional democracy, the legislature and the executive have clearly defined roles. The decision to build a new parliament is entirely the executive's.
Okay.
And where does it come from? It comes from a demand from the presiding officers of the two houses. The Honorable Lok Sabha Speaker and the Honorable Vice President. They have in a sense of the House resolution made the demand. But they are not the first to make the demand. Let me give you a bit of history. And if this is not consultation, what is? When I joined the Council of Ministers on 3rd September 2017, one of my first calls was on the Honorable Speaker, Sumitra Mahajanji. And the first thing she told me is, look, we need a new parliament. And I said, I'd be very happy to. Then she, in a few weeks' time, she called a meeting at which several people whom I remember were there. We had a discussion. I spoke to our people. I was assured there were already people looking at it. You see, this is not a project that could have been taken on in the first term because by the time you completed it, you know, 5 years were over. What we did was we were ready at that point of time. But
we ready put it, at which point of time?
Well, between 2014 and 2018, the thinking had been done. There was an informal committee. I can't share the names with you, but someday I will tell you. We're already working
on it. What was this informal thinking?
No, because, see, we need... Let me explain to you. The demand had come actually many years earlier. It is not Sumitra Mahajanji who is making the demand. It's not the Honorable Lok Sabha Speaker now or the Vice President made it. It was made in 2008. It was made in 1985. You look at the Estimates Committee of 1985, Mr. Rajiv Gandhi was the Prime Minister. It talks about the abysmal maintenance in the building. Then in 2012, Mr. Jairam Ramesh.
Jairam Ramesh is just an MP. I'm not sure that Jairam Ramesh's voice, you know, should carry
on. I'm only naming him. I'm only naming him because he's one of the most vociferous guys to say we don't need a new parliament. In an interview to The Hindu, July 2012, I can send you the cutting. He says, we need a new parliament. This one is outdated. It is non-functional.
No, surely you're not doing a new parliament because of Jairam Ramesh.
But no, we are doing it. We are doing it because we have needed it. We should have, if the Congress party had been able to, if the Congress party had... being able to do its work, it should have built a new parliament in 1947. right? But we were so much busy with other things.
What is the informal thinking about a new parliament?
Let me complete the facts here. There's a letter. I'll send you a photocopy. You can show it later. It's dated 13th July 2012. It is on somebody called Radhesham, addressed to Dr. Sudhir Krishna, Secretary, Ministry of Urban Development. And all the reasons for a new parliament are listed on behalf of the Honorable Speaker, Shrimati Meera Kumar. So this is the Congress Party, UPA's elected speaker, Meera Kumar, in 2012 saying, please let us get a new parliament. Now, the gentleman, the eminent economists and all the other eminences in that previous government, they didn't deal with it. Now,
which eminent economist? You're talking about Dr. Manmohan Singh?
Dr. Manmohan Singh was the prime minister then. There were so many other eminent people there, but they didn't deal with it. Now, we had a choice. We could also ignore it. Meanwhile, between in 1985 and now, the building has got worse. Number of MPs, there's no space. There is a plaster falling apart, air conditioning ducts, no place to sit. But there's another compelling reason, which is that the current freeze on the number of MPs, that freeze is going to go away with 5 years' time. When that goes away,
this is the delimitation of the constituencies.
So the delimitation issue. You're absolutely right. Then the number of MPs in the Lok Sabha will increase from 540 or thereabouts to 750. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now there's no place for them. Now, if you're going to build for 2025, you've got to start in 2020. Therefore, now we couldn't deal it. Meanwhile, the building is in seismic zone 4. You can't wait for it to come down. So what we have decided that, and this is full marks to the Prime Minister. He saw the trend. He saw where the demand was coming from. Decided to assume responsibility and build a parliament for the world's largest democracy. And I keep saying also one of the oldest democracies, as a befitting gesture on the occasion of the 75th anniversary of us as an independent nation, which is 2022. So now we've got all the clearances. We are getting on with the task. And that celebration is in October 2022. I think we'll get it done by August 2022.
So is that the informal thinking that you need a new building to commemorate 75 years of India's independence?
You need more MPs, and your MPs need a place to work in. Just now the parliament doesn't give you confidence on that. I sit in parliament during session morning to late evening. You can barely squeeze in there. And what's worse, MPs don't have a place to sit somewhere where they have a research assistant, somebody who can give them input. The only place MPs can sit is the central hall, where you have energetic journalists ready for exchange of political gossip and so on. There have to be meeting rooms where MPs can meet, where journalists can be, you can have meeting with journalists. The current building, which is an iconic historical building, will be maintained.
And what will happen to them?
We will have to redo it from inside, regut it, redo it inside. And you will have...
You're going to regut it, regut the parliament.
Inside, because, I can show you pictures. I can show you pictures. We can give you a demonstration. Inside, it's in a very advanced state of disrepair. If you read the 1985 Estimates Committee report, you'll even get it. 85 was many years ago.
So the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha will be gutted, and then you'll...
No. The exact whole building will, and we will make in there facilities for the propagation of democracy, Institute for Democratic Studies, Parliamentary Studies, where youth parliaments can have all kinds of activity. Whilst the main parliament building has enough space for the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, committee rooms, other facilities, research, library, etc. So it's going to be one of the most beautiful parliament buildings in the world. I'm saying this because we had a global design competition. It's open to entities all over the world. We had a very eminent jury. They selected one. We are now in the process, and I've probably seen more pictures than most people. But time flies very quickly. We are now in January of 2020. By about this time next year, most of it will be already physically standing, and we'll be doing the interiors.
So give me some idea of how it's going to look. So you have Parliament on the one hand, right next to Rashtrapati Bhavan. You have... at Vijay Chowk, of course, up the hill, you have Rashtrapati Bhavan and North Block, South Block. Are those also going to be changed and what happens to the Central Vista? If you can just...
Madam, so far, we have given out the contract only for two. One is the Parliament, and I just found out that also for the expansion of the Central Vista, I think a tendering process has taken place, and so they advanced it. After that, we'll be doing the 8 buildings, you know, which will house all the governments. That's not the government of India is strewn all over the world. You know, I mean, I worked 39 years for a ministry which had an office in, when I joined in Shastri Bhavan, I ended up in Akbar Bhavan, then you go to Patiala House, then you come back to XYZ. I mean, which foreign office in the world is spread over 6 locations, number one.
So where is your foreign office going to be?
Well, that they're coming. They'll all be in one place. They'll all be in one place. Just now, my colleagues in ME are very excited. What about our new Jawaharlal Nehru? We'll deal with that also. Just now, we
is
will
that
have...
to be demolished or not?
No, hold on. We'll deal with that. Now, what happens just now...
You're not saying no, Mr. Puri.
I'm not going to say yes or no because that has a time for each one of these. What I want to tell you is, we are spending not hundreds of crores, madam, 1,000 crores a year by way of rental. Government is a land-owning agency. Other people are occupying our buildings and we are paying rent. I mean, I have not come across. This is entirely of the Congress party's making. They were giving land to newspapers. One newspaper, you want to name, I'll give you. They are charging 30 lakhs of rupees to the MEA. And the newspaper hasn't been published for God knows how many years, at least 10 years. This is the kind of administration these guys have done. This is the kind of, government gives land to someone to run a newspaper. Guy stops running a newspaper, he's charging the government rent. Passport office is an MEA function. Why am I paying?
Can I just come back to North Block and South Block? Are those?
They will be kept exactly as it is from the outside. Internally also, they will be converted into, as per current thinking, museum. Every major capital in the world has space where people can go and see the documentation, audio visual documentation of their history, the freedom struggle, going back into our ancient civilization. So the current thinking is one of them will be a museum up to 1857, the other from 1857 to now, representing modern India from the first war of independence.
So South Block will be up to 1857 and North Block up.
Well, I don't know whether it's north or south or which one.
What about Rashtrapati Bhavan? Is that going to stay?
Or it's going to be remain exactly as it is. Rashtrapati Bhavan will remain as it is. What we are going to do is we are going to have an executive wing. We are going to have a defense wing, you know, so that governments are in one place. Now what happens? Let me give you an example. I am fortunate that I have a nice office in a Rivine. Otherwise, somebody goes for a meeting, spends half the time in commuting. You will be able to open up all these spaces to the people. This is a project dedicated by a democratically elected government to the people of India. Right. Suddenly, the Central Vista, which is what, 2.9 kilometers of cramped space, we will widen it. We will extend its length. It will go from 2.9 kilometers to something like 6.3 kilometers, exactly from the Rashtrapati Bhavan down to the riverfront.
So all the ministries will be in one place. And what happens to, say, when you say that these two museums, North Block and South Block, so National Museum will go to one of these museums?
Yeah, National, there's separate space found for that.
But I cannot let you go without a comment from you about, we're talking about democracies, and if you've probably seen pictures and visuals of what's happened in the US Capitol last evening, when protesters sort of overran the security and went into the house, what do you have a comment on that?
Well, look, I am not unfamiliar with the subterranean thinking and the strength of passions in democracies. I worked in the US, I worked in UK, Japan, India, etc. What happened there, I joined the mainstream narrative and saying this is completely unacceptable. An election was held, a constitutional process for transition for a new president and vice president to come in was held. And I'm glad that the House has certified it. This kind of behavior should find no place in any democracy anywhere else. And I'm choosing my words carefully, including in India. So all this, you know, right to protest peacefully is an inalienable right. You and I can disagree. We can stop talking to each other. We can sit, outside and protest. But there is no place for vandalism, hooliganism, and conduct of this kind.
But Donald Trump was a friend of India. He came to.
What has this got to do with you? You are a friend of mine.
Donald Trump who was instigating.
Hold on. This shows the strength of Indian democracy. We are wedded to the Constitution, and we deal with the United States and whoever its leaders are. But that doesn't mean if somebody who was our friend misbehaves, we'll say, no, you are my friend, and therefore I countenance or I agree with your misbehavior. Nobody is going to accept that.
Mr. Puri, on this note, as always, wonderful to talk to you, and thank you so much for your time. Thank you for speaking to me.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.